many arguments about the best ever. Better include Maureen Connolly, the first woman to win the Grand Slam in 53. The second was Margaret Smith Court, who dominated with physical strength when power didn't come from tennis rackets. Billie Jean King came along with an all-court game and mental toughness that took her to 20 Wimbledon titles, and Chris Evert's will and ground strokes earned her 18 majors in a long and storied career. Long and storied, Martina Navratilova started in Margaret Court's day and is still around. Every bit the physical player Court was, even better. Then one day in 87, the most natural of them all took over.
That special moment that day, I think that was, will always stick in my mind. And even knowing that I was there for such a long time and I got there again, it never was the kind of feeling again.
Grom had a record reign of 186 weeks till Monica Seles blasted through with 8 majors in 3 brilliant years. No woman could stop her, but a madman did. And now Grom is all alone again at the top of the game. Very much number one.
Who do you think is the best ever women tennis player?
I don't know if you can compare the years before, but I think the biggest player was Martina Navratilova.
What would it take for you to take over Martina's position as the best ever?
I'd have to play a couple more years, and I don't know how many more years I'm gonna play, but she's been playing for almost 20 years at very high standard, very high level, and that's something you just cannot put away.
Talk about your forehand.
Well, I can only say that I really had it from the beginning on. It's nothing that has been especially taught, or it's not really a forehand out of the book, like somebody would teach it to somebody, because I'm hitting it a little late, and I use my wrist a lot on it. But it's always been there, and it's something that always gave me a lot of confidence and gave me the chance to be an aggressive player.
Is it hard to believe for even you that at 24 years old you spent half your life playing professional tennis?
It is something that I never expected really from the start on. But I'm surprised myself realizing how many times I've been at certain tournaments, and I'm like, I've been doing this for 11, 12 years now, isn't it something? So I'm surprised myself.
You've got so many interests in your life. You've got a lot of different passions off the court. What are you going to do with the rest of your life?
I can't see myself just doing nothing. I'm such an active person that I want to start something, and I want to start something away from the tennis, because once I want to stop, I want to be done with tennis, even though I love the sport. But I think it's time then to keep moving on, doing something else.
All we know for sure is that when she is ready to go, she won't walk away from the game. It's not her style.
In the season, was Steffi Graf pushing the panic button? In Paris, bombed out of the semifinal by Mary Pierce, 6-2, 6-2. Never in the match. Then, in London, first round, Lori McNeil, the Houstonian, and she takes Graf out, building an incredible winning, losing streak. I asked Steffi, what is the state of Graf?
Two handle. Two consecutive defeats, so unusual in your life, Pierce and then McNeil.
How could I?
I don't know. How did you handle it?
Wow.
Do you break up the furniture? Do you smash windows, throw things?
I just took off for a week. You know, I didn't play tennis for about 3 weeks or so. And just did things other than tennis. You know, I just thought about other things. Yeah, and
such what things?
And I went fishing. I went
in Florida.
Actually, no, that was back home.
Uh-huh.
But go to movies. Just watched around. Just drove around. Just listened to music. Spent a lot of time with friends, which I haven't really had a lot to do. And so just not really tried to think too much about tennis. But it wasn't very difficult too.
But were those painful defeats?
Sure, I mean every loss itself is difficult, but I think on the other hand, which you learn through 10 or 12 years of tennis, is that a loss is not everything. And even if people say, you know, like you just said, two losses in a row. I mean, I don't really think of anything being that big, really. I mean, yeah, there are losses, but the good thing about the tennis is a couple of weeks later you have the next tournament coming up and you can do better. So I think that's what you learn.
Do you also learn to disregard people like me? By that I mean, we say Steffi is 45-3, 45 wins and 3 losses. What's wrong with her? What's wrong with her? What's going on?
No, I don't take it too hard, really. I don't think about it too much.
But you are not currently, or you haven't been, when you won the Australian Open over Arantxa Sánchez Vicario, who was playing very well. I mean, she didn't play badly in that match. You were on another planet. What has happened since then?
Well, I think until probably it was around Key Biscayne, I think I had an incredible year. I mean, I played some great tennis. I did get at the end of Key Biscayne, I did get tired of it. And even though I played great, I just needed some time away from the tennis. And that's what I took. And actually then I wanted to continue the way that I was beginning the year. I wanted to keep playing the way as well as I did. And I think I tried a little bit too hard because I worked way too much. And I entered the tournaments in Hamburg and I was just overpowered. I mean, I just lost so much energy in my workouts. I just spent too much time practicing and working out that I got into the tournaments very tired, actually. And I never really
could... New feeling for you?
Yeah. And I was surprised because I started losing weight and I didn't know why, because usually during tournaments I put on weight. And so all these things, and I didn't know what was going on. And it really started to get a problem, and then I just lost a little bit of touch, and then during Paris, and I was just not ready to play.
Encore, balle de championnat. Sánchez Vicario pénètre à l'intérieur du terrain et attaquera sans doute la deuxième balle.
Court, les balles sont
courtes. Deux balles extérieures. La championne 1994 des internationaux matinés, Arantxa Sánchez Vicario, qui l'emporte en 7-5, 6-1 et 7-6. Un match absolument époustouflant.
Oh, vraiment, jusqu'à la dernière minute, après tous les arrêts que ces joueurs ont subis aujourd'hui, vraiment, quelle présence, quel niveau de jeu.
I'd like to thank also all of the tennis fans here at the Jerry Stadium and across Canada who follow the action on CTV. Before we honor our champion, please join me in acknowledging the fine play of our runner-up, who received a check of $85,000, Madame Steffi Graf.
Difficult moment for me, but I want to congratulate Arantxa. The last time it was my turn, this time it's her turn. But I also want to thank everybody for staying out here that long. It was a long, long day, and it was great that you supported us that much.
Yeah.
also want to thank everybody who was involved into the tournament. John Bedding again did a great job, and everybody, the ball kids, all the umpires. And I've had quite some help this week from the trainer's room. Johnny, I want to thank you for the time. I think otherwise I wouldn't have been standing here today. And everybody who helped me.
It was all so innocent in the days before she could even hold a tennis racket. By age four, Steffi Graf had a firm grip on the game, showing off her future strokes. Victories became a way of life at six. Her powerful forehand first emerged when she was 10. A gangly teenager, Steffi was most comfortable on the tennis court where she had full command. At age 12, the first reporters learned of her shyness. In junior high school, tennis made Steffi the reluctant focus of attention. She preferred to escape to the courts where she had grown up. By 1987, Graf had knocked off Chris Evert to become the top-ranked player in the world.
I never again had that kind of feeling of being number one or being, you know, I felt on the top of where I wanted to be, and I've never had it ever again. It was such a special day.
There would be more special days. A Grand Slam in 1988, five Wimbledon crowns, and three U.S. Open titles. So what's left at 25 is Graf's fire burning out?
Other than myself, I don't think there are a lot of challenges anymore around. I've mentioned it before, I've won all the Grand Slams, and there are not any challenges left.
Is there ever a part of you that wants to pull a Michael Jordan, though, and just say, why not go out now? I'm on top.
Sure, I think I was surprised, and I have to say, I was surprised he had the guts to really do it the way he did it, and hopefully I can do it the same.
Some wonder if Graf is bored these days without Monica Seles and Jennifer Capriati to push her.
To not have them, sure, I miss it as well. I mean, there's no doubt about it. Because what I've always said, what I love about tennis is the challenge to be out there, to having to play good tennis and to be pushed and to have to be in these positions. And that's a difficult lesson, and that's kind of really sad.
Steffi's personality. Graf's friends have been trying to get the introverted champion to open up, but Australian player Renee Stubbs says the media's view of Graf is too dark.
Well, I think the dark thing comes out because she likes her curtains closed, and she doesn't like a lot of light in her room and stuff like that, she likes black, you know, clothes, and I mean, that's just, as years gone by, it's just kind of got grown as this dark side of her. I mean, she's far from that. People don't see the side of her that, you know, when you're a friend for life with her.
What makes you happiest?
To be able to use my time and do something fun with it, you know, do something that I enjoy. It can be a lot of different things. It can be going out with friends to a nice dinner, or it can be sitting on the beach. I mean, it can be listening to music. It can be a lot of things. Going to a concert. I think that there's a lot out there that can make you feel good.
Left alone?
Sometimes.
I mean, it seems sometimes like stardom is a little bit of a, not a burden, but it's a little bit of an intrusion. Would you prefer to have the tennis without the bright light.
But that would be probably the ideal thing, but it's something that you can't think of because it's just not the way it is.
You know, when you look at what's happened on the tour in the last couple of years, and in the last 5 or 6 years, the superstars that have come on the tour and boom, they've gone. Well, she's stayed on the tour, she's stayed at the top because she's learnt to shield herself from telling everybody about her innermost secrets.
So while Graf fiercely protects her privacy off the court, on the court she still looks for new challenges, yearning to recapture the exuberance of days past.
Steffi Graf has been in the public eye for over 10 years, but she has always cherished her privacy. Virginia Wade had a chance to spend a rare, quiet moment with the world's number one player as they visited the Queens Wildlife Center.
Do you feel when to be creative that it has to be something very physical for you, like a sport, or can it be much more reflective in reading or writing or painting? I mean, not painting, but...
I think I like people who are creative, but I don't think of myself being that creative of a person, I have to say.
Are you serious?
Yeah, I'm serious.
Well, what do you think you do on the tennis court?
Have fun, play.
I mean, don't you feel that tennis is for you your way of your creativity?
In a way, I think in a way. Maybe in a way of... But it's when I go out, I don't really think too much about that because...
When you go out on the court?
When I go out in the court, I mean, it's just... Do what I enjoy doing and try different things. I think I can be expressing a lot out there, but I don't know if it's too much creativity, I have to say.
But after you've put in all the hours of work and that, don't you feel that the inspiration comes out on another level, very high?
I mean, otherwise, I think you don't get the satisfaction of it. I think you're really trying to feel good out there, and you're trying to work on things and enjoy it, and you just go out and try your best, and I think when you see the result, I think you can enjoy it a lot more.
It's great to see you here so relaxed. Normally you feel as if you have to have you on a leash because you want to run away, but I also imagine at home you're actually very, very relaxed. I mean, I imagine that really deep down you are relaxed.
Difficult to answer this one because I am a person who likes to do things. I'm always very active. I have things like kind of planned and worked out, so I have lots of things that I want to do during the day, which keep me busy. I mean, I like to be busy.
Yeah.
And so I think I'm more relaxed than people think I am. But on the other hand, I think I'm a person who likes to be very active and sometimes it's getting a little bit hyper.
Not lazy.
Not lazy, no. I'm not a lazy person, no.
So what sort of things do you like doing in New York? What sort of concerts do you go to? I mean, don't you get tired?
No, I don't, not at all. I've seen actually, before the tournament, I've seen the Eagles, which I was really looking forward to. And it was a great concert at the Giants Stadium.
Fantastic.
And I saw a play with a couple of other players together. We went to see them Yankees, which was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
So I've been to movies, I've been to an exhibition, I've been just doing a lot of things. I mean, I still have not my apartment fully furnished, so I'm still looking around for pieces, and so I've been pretty active this couple of weeks.
Actually, that's really your first personal place, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. Which make it more special, obviously. You know, you walk right in and you like throw your things down, that's your place. This is the place, you know, when I saw it, I was like, I really would like to have that apartment. And when I got it, I mean, it was very special, it meant a lot to me.
Are you somebody who says in 5 years, I mean, I'm thinking of way back when you were maybe 10 years old and then 15 years old, did you actually sort of plan things or did you just wait I mean, not to see which way the mood swung, but played one day at a time sort of thing?
I did, actually. And at least I always thought I did. You know, I always said I never really wanted to be professional because I mean, I liked it to play, and I played a lot, but I never really enjoyed watching it, or I didn't follow it that much. I mean, I just wanted to play it. And but then again, this year I saw a little clip when I played my first big tournament in Berlin. I think I was 13 or 14 years old. I played qualifying, and I won my first match. And then this guy is like interviewing me right after the match, and he's like, you know, well done, and it's the first tournament for you, are you enjoying stuff? And I said, yeah, and it's like, what is your goal? And I'm like standing there saying, well, I want to be the best tennis player. And I'm standing there looking at this clip, and I'm like, oh, did I say that? So it was really funny looking at it, because I never really looked at myself wanting to be there when I was growing up. But I guess I wanted to be.
Steffi, listen, thanks. Thanks so much for talking to us.
Yeah, no problem.
Really nice to talk to, and it's difficult in the middle of a tournament.
Yeah.
And good luck.
Thank you.
And take care, and we'll see you down the line.
All
okay,
right.
Bye.
Bye, see you. Bye.